Wow, that sounded great. So let's move on. This is the program for this afternoon. First, we are now in the opening stage. First, Gerdine will then take us through the kick. Gerdine is now waving her hand. What is the kick about and what is a partnership? Then I will take you through the main elements of this call. And then we will have the Q&A session. So then we take all the questions from the chat box. Then we have a short break to allow everyone to take some to get back some energy. And then we will continue with the procedure on the suitability statement, the impact plan approach, which is a new element in this call. And then we end up with, again, another Q&A. So the timetable is a bit indicative. I think we can make it a bit flexible depending on where your interest is. So there were 50 participants who registered as of yesterday. And this is your background. I made a quick scan and you see that most of you are coming from university, but there's also quite a lot of interest already from private organizations. I also saw some people from university medical centers, from the University of Applied Sciences, and also one person from an organization for applied research. And then you indicated your interest in different KIAs, and this is how it looks like. Basically, this shows the background of all the participants. Most of you have a background or are working in the health and care sector. Others in the key technologies. Then there is the energy transition and sustainability on the third place. Agriculture, also quite some interest there. And even people interested and working in the public earning capacity and safety field of research. So this shows that there is quite a diverse spectrum here present. And I think that's nice because it's the first time that we offer this instrument for the whole of NWO, let's say for the whole research community. And it shows that well, we were able to attract already quite a diverse public towards this call. So those are my starting remarks. I would now like to give the floor to Gerdine, who will introduce us what the kick is about and what the partnership is about.
Thank you, Bram, for this brief introduction. I will start, obviously, by sharing my screen. So for me, it is a great pleasure to introduce to you the Knowledge and Innovation Covenant and at least try to give you some guiding principles with respect to the demand-driven partnerships. My name is Gerdine Stout. I'm coordinator of this instrument for NWO, which means that this is my role here also in this meeting. I would like to welcome you as well, also on behalf of everyone involved with all the knowledge and innovation conference instruments that are actually developed by NWO. We have more and more we encounter as people a lot of societal challenges. Basically, in our personal life, our private life, and also our professional lives. And these issues are quite large, actually. And it is no longer possible to discuss or tackle these issues just by a single angle approach. That is why this gives the opportunity to innovative research, particularly with impact. And it also provides scientists, industry, and society to collaborate together and to explore new avenues basically to find solutions and answers to these societal challenges. Now, in order to put this into perspective, the government actually developed a mission-driven top sector and innovation policy. And because of that, they asked all the sectors involved to draft some knowledge and innovation agendas. And there is four main themes that you all perfectly well know. There's one more technological-driven knowledge and innovation agenda, as well as a more systemic one. The overarching aim is actually to reach societal, including economical impact for these societal challenges. Now, NWO contributes to this policy by actually the development of public-private partnerships and funding instruments that are linked to that. There's four main lines in which we actually invest. So there is the mission-driven calls that are actually developed by the priorities that actually have been defined in the knowledge and innovation agendas. Each year, the PIAs are actually asked to do this again and again. So these result in thematic calls that actually are available for all researchers. There's a more strategic driven program, which actually has been developed to provide structural funding for sustainable collaborations, aiming to establish long-term coupling of science and societal challenges. And there's a fourth line, basically for more the practice-oriented research. Today, this meeting actually is about the demand-driven partnerships, and I would like to stress that all of these instruments have four main characteristic points of view and aspects. So first of all, the focus of all these four instruments is the utilization of knowledge and the focus on impact. And all these instruments all have a focus or the possibility to work in an interdisciplinary collaboration to actually address human capital or use human capital in your proposals to make it stronger and to collaborate with universities for applied sciences or even international collaborations. I will not go into this in great extent because for this particular instrument, Bram will actually give you this in the more call-specific information. For now, I will try to show you the guiding principles behind the demand-driven partnerships. So basically, for all the demand-driven partnerships, you have to keep in mind that knowledge and development of questions that are formulated by the partners that work together, these are shared among the partners. And actually, one of the requirements is that obviously these research questions or development questions fit within parts of one or more knowledge and innovation agenda. This means that basically you decide what your partnership is going to be about. So it's a bottom-up approach. And actually provide you the opportunity to also work cross KIA. So even a topic that is in between the KIAs maybe. And also what you think is good that it is a topic where a focused approach, a dedication and coherence can make a difference for impact. And what we also would like to do is to have this reflected in the volume expressed in time and money. And that means that we have large substantial programs that we would like to do for these partnerships. So between 3 and 10 million euros. Another guiding principle is that we would like to collaborate and co-fund this partnership in a 50-50 character. This means that NWO has a contribution of 1.5 million euros to 5 million euros, and we ask the remaining part from the partners that are actually working on a partnership. And we would like to reach societal impact by connecting scientific disciplines. Different parties create new networks and facilitating and funding these public-private research and innovation initiatives. I've so far to give you the main guiding principles, but we actually have developed two different instruments within the demand-driven partnership line. One is with partners, and one is specifically for consortia. The remaining slides in this presentation I have will actually focus on the demand-driven partnerships with the partners. And the next contribution from Brown will provide you more insights on the demand-driven partnerships for consortia. So if you look at demand-driven partnership for public and private partners, we have an open partnership desk, as we call it, where public and private parties that would like to address a knowledge and innovation question or knowledge and development question together with NWO can reach out to us and share their idea. What we expect from them is that they share their idea not only on content, but also provide us some insights into their willingness to contribute this and their financial commitment. Like I said, we would like to ask partners to at least invest 1.5 million euros. And if everything goes well, then NWO matches that, that amount of money. So NWO actually selects the ideas if there is a lot of demand for this instrument, and then would make us allows us to make a budget reservation for the demand-driven partnerships that we would like to develop together with these public and private partners. If we develop this, then the development and the knowledge question that I would like to address will actually be the theme of the call for proposals that we will develop together with the partners. And after publication of this thematic call, researchers will be invited to submit a research proposal. Research proposals will be actually assessed, obviously, based on the impact they would like to reach and the quality. And NWO obviously facilitates the assessment procedure that is required to do so. If the projects are awarded, then we will get, obviously, a partnership program where we can monitor the awarded partnership program as well as the partnership projects. And we also will do this according to the impact plan that Ron Winkler will ask you or tell you more about in the later stage. So to give you a small example of what we did here is that, for example, with the domain of applied engineering sciences, one of the large networks that we have reached out to us and they said, well, we have a very nice consortium of actually companies. And they were interested in genetic engineering. However, they get a lot of data from this and did not know where the best information specialist would be. So what they did together with NWO is draft a thematic call for proposals with that idea. And now they have very nice connections with this information and IT specialist. And they connected scientific knowledge to their research and development. And now have a new line of investigation also within them, within their consortium. For the demand-driven partnership with consortia, I would like to give the floor to Bram, because this is actually what I wanted to tell you for now.
Yeah, thank you, Gardina. So I hope you have now a bit of a background in the knowledge and innovation contract. And also the partnership for, the demand-driven partnership for partners. Let me now share my screen. So we now move into the call itself that we are, where this webinar is about, the call Demand-Driven Partnerships for Consortia. So this call is meant for, let's say, those networks that are already formed, where there is already a consortium formed and that is willing to apply for a grant, then this call can be very well suitable. The objective of the call, I'd like to start with this, with the objective, because it contains already the necessary elements that we will strongly look at. The objective is to fund demand-driven research by consortia to achieve societal, including economic impact on the societal challenges as defined by the mission-driven top sector and innovation policy. I now go through this objective one by one. First, the call is aimed or is for demand-driven research by consortia. What do we mean with a consortium? A consortium here means at least two knowledge institutions and at least one private co-funder. And on top of that, you may include also public co-funders and also collaboration partners without who do not provide co-funding. Collaboration partner could still be interesting to take on board in the consortium, because they can help you to bring, let's say, the knowledge from the academic world towards a place where you can make impact. Importantly, universities of applied science can also receive funding in this call. This is also, I think, a new element for partnerships. So it's important to specify or to stress. As Gerdine explained, you can choose the knowledge and development question yourself as a consortium. So we expect that knowledge institutions and the co-funders together at the start already think and co-create co-design their own proposal with this question. And this close cooperation, we expect that to run from start to finish. So close cooperation is key in this goal. The project budget you can request is 3 to 10 million euros in cash. So it's quite a significant budget, I would say. However, a high level of cash co-funding is required. A partnership at NWO always has been 50-50% of co-funding, and this 50% applies to the cash budget. So NWO contributes 50%, and the co-funders provide 50%, and at least 30% of the co-funding, or of the, let's say, the total budget, is from private origin. Of course, in-kind co-funding is possible, but it will not be counted as co-funding in this as this picture indicates. So this is the co-funding that is required. Then we go to the aim. The aim is to achieve societal impact, and societal impact includes economic impact. It includes also ecological impact, all kinds of societal impacts are included in this definition. And I think Ron will explain more about this after the break. The research problem that you should analyze has a scientific origin, let's say. It has a scientific perspective, but also a societal perspective. And that is important also to stress. It's not only a scientific problem that is addressed, but it's ultimately is also some kind of societal problem that is addressed. And we take a strong look at it in the assessment. So the problem analysis and the route to impact is 50% of the overall assessment. So that's quite an important element, I would say. To help you with this route to impact, we have developed an approach. This is called the impact plan approach. And after the mini break, Ron will explain to you a bit more about this impact plan approach. Although we will also organize a separate webinar about it. But to give you a flavor, it's a structured approach that helps you to really go step by step from, let's say, the societal challenge that you address towards your ultimate research question. And then from your research question, go back towards the societal impact that you want to achieve. And this step-by-step approach is called the impact plan approach. You can also reserve a budget, of course, for all the activities that relate to impact and knowledge utilization. And this is 5 to 10% of the budget requested from NWO. So this is also a budget that you can use to realize this impact, or to give it at least sufficient attention. Of course, impact is sometimes out of the scope of your own project, but anyways. On the societal, then the last part of the objective, that is about the scope of the research. It should fit within the mission-driven top sector and innovation policy. And for that, as Gerdine explained, we have 6 knowledge and innovation agendas. You can find them here in this link, topsectoren.nl/missiesforthetoekomst. There you find links towards these 6 KIA's. There you can see directly what they are about. And we will check whether it fits these one of these KIA's by means of a suitability statement. And the procedure I will explain later in more detail. So these are the essential elements of a proposal, I would say. but NWO offers a rich palette of opportunities to allow you to really make and develop the best proposal possible. I think it's quite unique that we have various budget modules available to do this, new budget modules that were not used before. So please take a good look at it. For example, the last bullet, international collaboration, there are 2 budget modules related to international collaboration. In that way, you can involve international researchers to your project. You can allow them to visit your group. You can organize international symposia. You can even, international researchers can be important abroad. So that is, many things are possible. As I said, collaboration with universities of applied sciences is also highly encouraged, because that takes research from the academic towards the more practice, towards the practice, towards the, let's say, in the end, the society. We also encourage you to think about human capital and learning communities, to connect to existing learning communities or start a new community yourself. Such a community is a collaboration between a knowledge institute, an educational institute, and a company, for example, and they have a place where people work and learn and innovate at the same time. And it is thought that these communities help to train people to work in a dynamic environment, which is useful to really bring innovation further. And another example, you can make use of industrial and societal doctorates. These are, let's say, doctorates or doctoral students from a company or from another organization, and you can make them part of your research project. So these are examples how you can really beef up the project proposal and make a difference. The call consists of 2 rounds. So we have now round 1 running. The second round will be in summer next year. The available budget at this time is only 6 million. This is a bit low, but it will be increased early next year, because we realize that that is 6 million is definitely not enough to facilitate 2 rounds. So it will be increased probably by another 6, but we have to see how this works out. There are important deadlines, obviously. The first one is 16th of February next year. This is to apply for the suitability statement and by email. And the other 2 deadlines, the pre-proposal and the full proposal, those are deadlines where you submit your documents by means of our submission system called ISAIC. Then perhaps you've already seen that as of this week, NWO has a new website. It looks very nice, but it comes also with a some startup problems, I have to say. So But let me explain you how the site works. We have, let's say, a program page for where the program itself is explained. And we have a call page here in the left, where all the downloads are available and where you can really do the submission. And importantly, you see here these bullets or these phases: explore, prepare, and submit. Under prepare, if you click on prepare, you see all the downloads that are available that you need for the pre-proposal and later on the full proposal. Unfortunately, we included all kinds of links in the call text, and due to the new websites, most of them are not working anymore. We are still working on to fix it, but bear with us for a little while, because it takes time to make sure that all these links are fixed. I think that is what I liked, what I'd like to say, and it's now time for the questions. Anna-Marie, can you have a look in the chat box and see if we have some questions that we can address?
Yes, of course. I received two questions. The first question is there a requirement that the two knowledge institutions have to be both Dutch institutes, or at least one Dutch and one foreign institute is allowed?
No, we require at least two, not necessarily Dutch institutes, but at least institutes in the Kingdom of the Netherlands, if I'm correct. So basically Dutch institutes, you can say.
Okay. And the other question on the chat, can both Dutch and non-Dutch private parties participate?
Yes, indeed. Also non-Dutch private organizations can participate as, let's say, a co-founder organization or a collaboration partner. Yeah, so it's also an international consortium is allowed in that sense.
Okay, and I received a question from Marcel. Could you please share the new links with all participants of this session via email? And do you mean the new links on our website? Yes. Okay, maybe I can share them via the chat, because it's, yeah.
Well, it's a lot. There are many links not working, so mm-hmm. it's we have to look first where the information is going. Mm-hmm. But it will be fixed. I mean, and otherwise, give us a call for the information that you are looking.
Yeah. But okay, so I'm receiving new questions. For industrial PhD, how much time should the PhD be located in the university, and how much in industry?
This is for an industrial doctorate. I think that's the question about. Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, there are no specific rules on that, if I'm right. So I think this, let me come back on this specific question also later to first sort it out. But if I'm right, there is no rule attached to where you are working as an industrial doctorate.
Okay, another question about the co-financing. Is there a required minimum in the in-cash co-financing that has to come from for-profit versus non-profit?
This is a question about in-kind co-funding?
In-cash.
Oh, so sorry.
Is there a required minimum in the in-cash co-financing that has to come from for-profit versus non-profit?
Yes. So we have we made a breakdown, and we said, okay, 50% of the budget is co-funding. And this co-funding, let's say, is for, if you only look at the co-funding, then 60% is from private origin and 40% is from non-private origin. And for the definition of private, we rely on the definition that has been, that is used by the Dutch Enterprise Agency, RVO in Dutch. They have definitions on their website where they specify what is public and what is private. And we also use the same definition.
Okay. And another question. Should all the co-funding has to be in cash, or also when SMEs participate?
Yes, all the co-funding that we are counting, let's say for also the MVO contribution, is cash. But an SME can still contribute in, for example, in kind. I mean, it's not counted as eligible co-funding, but it definitely counts in the evaluation of your consortium quality. So if the assessment, one of the criteria is quality of the consortium, and then an SME definitely brings in additional value and can, so these are then bonus points.
There are no more questions in the chat.
Okay. If there are no more questions in the chat, then I think we are running nicely on time. Perhaps new questions pop up. That is okay, because we have another question round at the end. Then I suggest we now take a mini break of, let's say, shall we do 10 minutes? Perhaps we can do 10 minutes right now. It's now, let me check the time. So 7 past 4. Okay, let's resume 20 past 4. Perhaps that's okay. Yes? Okay, see you then 20 past 4. Okay, on my on my watch it is 20 past four, so let's resume. The program for the rest of this webinar is as follows. I will first explain you some procedural steps related to the suitability statement. Then Ron will take us through the impact plan approach. He will introduce this approach and make you a bit more familiar with it so that you know what you can expect later on in the full proposal phase. And then we have plenty of time for Q&A. So I hope your break was nice. You have a new cup of coffee or tea and some new energy for the rest of this webinar. The suitability statement then. We made a procedure that looks as follows. Suitability statement, that is a form basically that shows that your research proposal fits with at least one of the six KIAs. The six KIAs have been already mentioned before, but here you see on the, a screenshot from this website, topsectoren.nl/missies-for-the-toekomst. Here you can find direct links to all these different KIAs. Some of the KIAs consist of different sub agendas. But in principle, all these, the scope of all these KIAs can be found here. And what we like to ask here is that your research fits at least one or multiple KIAs. And so what you do is you can find on our call web page, you can find a form in which you can request the suitability statement. This form you fill in and you send it to NWO. Then NWO will send it to the KIA official secretary that is linked to your primary KIA. This table shows you who are the official secretaries. So mostly it's a top sector, basically, that fits logically with these KIAs. And these top sectors, they coordinate this assessment. That means that they will find the right, they will look for the right person with the right expertise who can make a judgment on the fit. And they will, and then this check will be done. The KIA will sign. If it fits, they will sign and send the form back to NWO, and NWO will send back the form to you. And then you have a signed suitability statement. And this is a required form for your pre-proposal. So that is in short how it works. Now, suppose that you have a question about suitability. You are not exactly sure. Then we like to encourage you to consult the official secretary yourself. Directly, and to ask your question directly to them, because they are in charge of this assessment and NWO is not. So anything we say, is basically not helping you in the end to get this official signature. you can contact them directly, and of course this is unofficial, because the official then you get an idea whether you will fit or not, and then the official route is this form, which will follow the steps that I previously mentioned. So this is basically everything I'd like to explain about this particular step in the process. I hope things are clear, and perhaps it's good in view of the structure to, if there is a burning question on this specific procedure right now, to take it directly.
There is no specific question on this part of the procedure.
Okay, well, perhaps it comes up later, then you can already, you can again ask it. But then I'd like to introduce Ron. Ron is our colleague who is basically an expert in the impact plan approach and helping us to implement it in our organization and in our calls. And Ron, I'd like to give the floor now to you, so you can help us to understand the impact plan approach.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be telling you a little bit more about knowledge utilization at NWO. You've heard the word impact several times by now. But what do we mean by that? And how new is it? Because it was referred to as something completely new. Is it new? Yes and no. No in the sense that for years we've already been asking people on to think about how they will achieve some form of impact from their research. Yes, in the sense that now we're giving people a tool, a framework on how to think about achieving impact from their research. It's stuck. One second. Just change the. Why is it not working?
Yeah, we saw your first slide and then yeah, it was stuck.
You should. Okay, it's not the presentation view, unfortunately, but we'll have to do it this way. Sometimes it gets stuck in the knowledge utilization. So before I can explain about the method, I will just refer to, like this, it's really annoying. I should give you a few, it works. I should give you a few definitions. The NWO mission is to advance world-class scientific research that has scientific and societal impact. The definition of societal impact for us is that all kinds of changes, cultural, economic, et cetera, that are entirely or in part the consequence of knowledge and expertise generated by the research. Knowledge utilization, which I referred to before, is the use of knowledge through productive interactions with targeted stakeholders to create societal value. That leads us to the last definition we're going to introduce, productive interactions. What do we mean by productive interactions? This is actually a very important part of this method. There are relational factors that support the knowledge use from research that can be steered intentionally. If you cannot affect the party involved, then you cannot steer it, and then it doesn't really help in achieving impact. They can be direct, personal, indirect, or financial, and they are a measure of this potential societal impact. So we will be looking at the possible productive interactions in your impact plans, which I'll come to later, to get an idea of how good the chances of actually achieving impact eventually. Two examples of productive interactions are co-design, when you're formulating research questions and approaches together with potential end users, or co-creation, when you jointly execute a research project. So for instance, a company gives the time of one of the researchers in kind to the project itself, or materials, so they're jointly executing the research project, and the interactive dialogue about research results. We do expect people to come together at least once or twice a year, hopefully more, to talk about the research result. And altogether, that process is a co-creation process. Now, NWO implements the new knowledge utilization approach in three different approaches. There's impact outlook, there's impact plan, and there's impact focus. The difference between them is that the impact outlook is more focused on a scientific question, not necessarily a societal challenge. Impact focus, it focuses on concrete steps from knowledge to utilization. But we'll be talking about the impact plan approach, research that aims to contribute to addressing societal issues. And that has to have an integrated strategy on productive interactions, which we talked about previously, the theory of change, and the impact pathway, as well as concrete steps to develop these. Theory of change. This is central to this approach, that you go from the problem area to be addressed, to the eventual impact. And this approach will help you to think critically about the desired societal change. When you go from problem to research, there are all kinds of assumptions in there. What are the causes of the problem? What are the underlying knowledge-related causes? For each step, you have to explicate the assumptions underlying the perceived process of change. And the interesting part is that if you do that with a group of different partners, you can see that people have completely different assumptions on what the causes are. If you put an engineer and a social scientist next to one another, they might think about it completely different, let alone an NGO or a company. And this part is really important because altogether you have to define the research questions. So by giving input before you start the project, or before you even write the proposal itself, you can help shape the entire project. It enables a reflective approach in planning and steering based on monitoring process progress. So during the execution of the project, every so often you come together to have a meeting, and at that meeting, you look at your theory of change and see if things have changed, because you could have very interesting results that negate some of your previous assumptions. And that means you should change your theory of change. It provides insight into the assumed causal logic of output, outcome, and impact. I'll get to that in a second. And what's overlying and really important is what kind of productive interactions are needed in the whole theory of change. You need productive interactions to go from the research results to the impact, but you also need productive interactions to go from the problem itself to the research in the project. And you co-create this whole thing together with a consortium. And you can see that on my left, the problem, there's a problem analysis. The other side, the right, is the impact pathway. What is an impact pathway? That's an iterative pathway from knowledge to societal impact. If we start from the project, you have what we call a sphere of control. That's the project consortium and core stakeholders. And they together, they create outputs. So the results within the project, the results we see as the output from direct output from the project, and that entails knowledge sharing and co-creation. There's a larger sphere, the sphere of influence. That's mostly the stakeholders. It's where the scientists more or less hand over the baton to the stakeholders to get to the outcomes, which can be a machine that has to be built or a process that has to be designed, that will eventually lead to the sphere of interest. And that last part is where you generate your impact. The impact will be generated by stakeholders and target groups. You could think of doctors who get a new method to cure diseases of patients, for instance. So on the left, you see output, the direct immediate insights obtained by a research project. The outcome are changes in behavior, relationships, and actions by stakeholders, and the impact, the changes in society. So altogether, it demonstrates how a project can contribute to outcomes and impact. Another way to show this, and this is sort of how it looks, but you will have to write for the project itself, is that you have three columns here, and you can basically go from one side to the other as long as there's a logical relation between the research outputs and the impact. Of course, you don't know exactly beforehand what the research outputs will be, But if you want a desired change, you can logically go back to what kind of insights do you need? And I'll have an example of that so that makes it more visible. So the impact pathway illustrates how the process of change is expected to unfold over time. And it explicits the desired outputs and outcomes to reach impact. And it actually shows who needs which insights to be able to contribute or facilitate the desired change. So an example, I always like to work with examples to make it more visible. Organ perfusion. There's a long waiting list for organs. That's the problem to be addressed. One of the assumptions is that the amount of unusable organs leads to longer waiting lists. So the cause, unusable organs because of quality decline between removal and implantation. The assumption then is that acceptance of organs can be improved with perfusion. The underlying knowledge related causes would be to know more about how the organs decline and how perfusion technology might work. If you go to the output, you get insights in how the organs decline and you get a set of requirements for an organ perfusion machine. With requirements, that's what we assume, if you have the right requirements, a device can be developed. Yes, a manufacturer builds and markets the device, that's an intermediate outcome, but the outcome will be that there's a higher success rate of transplantations. And successful organ transplantation leads to an improved quality of life. And that's what your eventual impact will be, more people with an improved quality of life after successful transplantation. Again, to show it in a slightly different way, insights from the project, the outcome is changes in behavior, a manufacturer places a device on the market, the impact are the changes in society, a longer and healthier life. So that's in really short an explanation on how this method, the impact plan method, works. Some final remarks is that the theory of change and an impact pathway are tools to monitor and reflect. It's not set in stone and it's not used for accounting in the end. So we won't say, well, at the beginning of the project, you wrote this theory of change and now you're in a completely different, your results don't correspond with the theory of change. Your project failed. Now, in fact, we'll expect you to evaluate it once or twice a year and see if the theory of changed, and it can be completely different at the end of the beginning, most likely, but there could be a lot of changes as the research progresses, and you would also maybe expect it to attract different partners, or some partners might leave because the targets, the aims they were working for don't correspond anymore with the new theory of change. So it's a flexible process that helps you to think about how to best achieve impact. And be sure, NWO will organize workshops to facilitate the process. It's not like we'll send you a form and we'll send you some information and then you have to do all of this. It does take a bit of work, but we will organize workshops to help you make these first theory of change and impact pathways. Any questions?
Yeah, thank you, Ron, for this very clear and structured presentation. Yes, let's go to the chat box and see if there are any questions. Anne-Marie, can you help us to go through them?
Yes, of course. There is one question that is also relevant for the rest of the participants. So I think it's a question for you, Bram. It's related to the talk of Ron. The question is, can the general public be involved and be part of the consortium? For example, we have ideas to conduct focus group studies with our intended target population in our research execution. If this is allowed, can we bring in crowdfunding, for example, to use as in cash co-funding from the private parties in the consortium?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it is very interesting. I mean, it all depends a bit on your research question, whether the general public should be included or not. But if you believe that involving the general public will help you to reach more impact or to make this translation towards the society, then I would definitely do that. There can be collaboration partners, as I explained, who are part of the consortium but have no co-funding. In that form, you can bring in a certain organization with that represents the general public. But you can also leave them out of your consortium and use them as stakeholders. For example, as Ron explained, stakeholders, they become important when there is output and you bring output to the stakeholders. Then you can also say, we will, in the end of the project, reserve time and resources to talk to stakeholders like this or that group. So that's another option in which you can use or bring in, let's say, the use of these public groups. So they can be part of the consortium or they can be left outside of the consortium, but still be involved in the impact plan. Is crowdfunding allowed? Difficult question. I mean, I have no experience with that. I mean, the co-funding should be pledged upfront. So when you submit the full proposal, there should be cash budget available and pledged by the co-funder. And whether or not the co-funder received it by crowdfunding or not, I mean, that does not really matter. It should be there and it should be spent on the research proposal. I hope this is sufficient for now on this question.
Okay, there is another question about the impact plan workshop. When will the workshop on impact plan approach be organized? And is the impact plan approach as described in that workshop the same as the impact plan approach mentioned in other NWO grants?
Yeah, it is the same. So the impact plan here is the same as the impact plan in the Dutch research agenda or in other KIC calls. So that is quite nice. Once we all are familiar with how it works, it should be become more normal, let's say, to work with it. When the workshop is planned for May, because by the end of April, we will send feedback on the pre-proposals that have been submitted. The feedback can be positive, but it can also be negative. So a negative advice. So in May, basically, we expect the positive, those who receive the positive advice to develop the full proposal. So we expect May to be a good time for, let's say, a next session on the impact plan approach.
Okay, there are no other questions.
But the explanation by Ron was already very useful in my view. I mean, it basically pinpoints all things that you need to know. So you can already look now for the right stakeholders or the right, let's say, consortium partners. You can go through your theory of change yourself. I mean, it's no rocket science. So I believe you can already start thinking about it right now, but you only need to write down in the full proposal phase, let's say, these steps that Ron described. How much of the funded budget can be spent on material costs versus personnel costs? That's a good question. I think there are, I have to check myself because there are some limitations, obviously, to the material budget. Yeah, so the material budget is related to a personnel, and for each personnel you can request 15k per year. So for a PhD you can request 60k material budget.
So there are no more questions in the chat.
No more questions in the chat. Okay, then I assume that everything was clear. One more question is coming in right now. Are there more guidelines to how the cash contribution from NWO should be distributed among the consortium partners? How the cash contribution from NWO should be distributed among the consortium partners? Well, it works like this. The cash contribution by the public and private partners is sent to NWO. And then we grant it together with our own budget to the main applicant. And the main applicant is then responsible for the distribution of the grant according to the research proposal. And the origin of the cash co-funding has been already explained previously. I mean, it's, let's say, if you only look at the cash co-funding, then 60% is from private origin at least, and 40% is from, can be from public origin. And in this presentation and also in the call for proposals, there's a nice picture that also explains how this works. What I also, I think is important to, what I can also tell right now is that we are working now on a budget, let's say an Excel file that helps you to create your budget. This Excel file is still in progress, but will be put on our call webpage once it is ready. The same holds for the full proposal template. Also, that one is still in the development, but we will put it on our website anytime.
There's another question. Can the main applicant only come from a university, like someone who has a permanent position, or he, she can also come from a private partner?
Yeah, no, it should not come from a private partner. It should come from a knowledge institute. So not only a university, but there are some more organizations that, like a university medical center, even a University of Applied Research can host a main applicant, but the list of organizations is explicated in the call text. So I just want you to refer to this list in the call for proposals.
Yes, there was another question, maybe in line with a previous question. Can private partners receive from either the NWO contribution or the INCAS co-financing contribution? Or can only knowledge institutes receive funding? And this is an important question.
Yeah, no. To be very good question, no, the co-funding organizations cannot receive funding from NWO, so they will not receive any grant. Perhaps with one exception, I have to check. That is the industrial doctorate. I'm not sure how that works, but there you have a person who is, of course, financed by a company. I'm not sure how that exactly works, but in principle, the cash budget that is contributed goes towards the Knowledge Institute, who will then spend it on all the items that are in the research plan, and that researchers, investments, but also a project manager you can fund, or hosting a workshop or a symposia. There are several, there's a variety of activities basically that you can finance through this grant, but it will not go to the companies that co-financed.
No more questions at this moment.
All right, then I think we should close this webinar. I'd like to thank all participants for participating. If you have any questions later on, don't hesitate to contact us via the email address that is on our website. You can also contact us directly or by phone or by email. And well, let's hope that you can find the right, that you can find sufficient co-funding sources and good research ideas. And then we wish you good luck and all the best in developing good proposals. Thanks and have a good evening.
Thank you. You too.